didn't think it polite to listen. So I'm sorry for that, for your sake. I don't play accurately. Anyone can play accurately, but I play with wonderful expression. As far as the piano's concerned, sentiment is my forte. I keep science for life.
Yes, so.
Speaking of the science of life, have you got the cucumber sandwiches cut for Lady Bracknell?
Yes, so.
Memories are so curiously constituted. There's no use speculating.
frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
But I wish you would offer one. I happen to be more than usually hard up.
Well, there is no good offering a large reward now that the thing has happened.
Yes, well, that makes no matter, for now that I look on the inscription inside, this isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times, and you have no right whatsoever to read what is written inside. It is a very ungentlemanly thing to read a private cigarette case.
It is absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should read and what one shouldn't. More than half of our culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
I am quite aware of the fact, and I don't propose to discuss monoculture. It isn't the sort of thing one should talk of in private. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is a present from someone of the name of Cecily, and you said you don't know anyone of that name?
Well, if you want to know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes. Charming lady she is too. Lives at Tunbridge Wells. Give it back to me, Algy.
If she was your aunt, who is at Tunbridge Wells, why does she call herself Little Cecily? From Little Cecily with her fondest love.
My dear fellow, what on earth is there in that? Some aunts are tall. Some aunts are not tall. Surely that is a matter that every aunt may be allowed to decide for herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be exactly like your aunt. That is absurd! Now, for heaven's sake, give me back my cigarette case.
Yes, but why your aunt calling her uncle? From Little Cecily with her fondest love to her dear Uncle Jack. There's no objection, I admit, to an aunt being a small aunt. But why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, should call her own nephew her uncle, I can't quite make out. Besides, your name isn't Jack after all. It's Ernest.
It isn't Ernest. It's Jack.
You have always told me it was Ernest. You answer to the name of Ernest. I've introduced you to everyone with the name of Ernest. You look as if your name was Ernest. You're the most earnest thing I've ever saw in my life. It is perfectly absurd you're saying your name isn't Ernest. Here's one of them. Mr. Ernest Worthing, before the opening. I'll keep this as proof that your name is Ernest. If you ever attempt to deny to me, or to Gwendolen, or to anyone else.
Well, my name is Ernest in town and Jack in the country. The cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that does not account for the fact that your small Aunt Cecily, who lives at Tunbridge Wells, calls you her dear uncle. Come on, old boy, you'd better have the whole thing out at once.
My dear fellow, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It is very vulgar to talk like a dentist when one isn't a dentist. It produces a false impression.
But that is what dentists always do. Now, go on. I may tell you that I have always suspected you of being a Bunburyist, and I'm quite sure of it now.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by a Bunburyist?
I'll reveal you the meaning of that incomparable expression as soon as you were to tell me why you were Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation. And really, it's improbable.
My dear fellow, there is nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it is perfectly ordinary. The old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle from motives of respect to you could not possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country, under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
nothing to you, dear boy. You are not going to be invited. I may tell you quite candidly the place is not in Shropshire.
I suspected that, my dear boy. I have Bunbury's all over Shropshire on two separate occasions. Now, go on. Why are you Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, I don't know whether you will be able to understand my real motives. You are hardly serious enough. When one is placed in the position of guard, one has to adopt a very high moral tone on all subjects. It is one's duty to do so. And as a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce very much to either one's health or one's happiness, in order to get up to town, I have always pretended to have a younger brother by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany and gets into the most dreadful scrapes. That, my dear Algy, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is fairly pure and never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if it were, and modern literature a complete impossibility.
That wouldn't be at all a bad thing.
Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. Don't try it. They do it so rarely in the daily papers. But you really are some Bunburyist. I was very right in saying you're a Bunburyist. You're one of the most advanced Bunburyist I know.
What on earth do you mean?
You have invented a useful younger brother of the name of Ernest, so that you may be able to go to town as often as you like. I have invented a perfectly invaluable invalid friend of the name of Bunbury. Bunbury's dreadful invalid. If it wasn't for Bunbury's choosing that help, for instance, I wouldn't be able to dine with you at Willis's tonight, for I have been rather engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week at this time.
I haven't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You're perfectly careless about sending out invitations. It is very foolish of you. Nothing bothers me more than not receiving an invitation.
You had much better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I haven't the smallest intention of doing anything of the kind. In the first place, I dine there on Monday, and once a week is enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, I'm always treated as a member of the family. Either sit down with no limit at all, or two. In the third place, I know perfectly well what she will say to me next to Mary Farquhar, who always bled with her own husband across the dinner table. And that thing is enormously over increased, my dear fellow. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands in public is perfectly scandalous. It is simply washing one's own clean linen in public. Besides, now that I know you to be a Bunburyist, I want to know your secrets. I want to tell you the rules.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolen accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I will kill him in any case. Cecily is a little too much interested in him. It is rather poor. So I'm going to get rid of Ernest. And I strongly advise you to do the same with Mr. With your invalid friend who has the absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury. And you'll be very glad to know Bunbury if you do get married, which seems to me extremely problematic. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
Oh, that is nonsense. If I marry a charming girl like Gwendolen, and she's the only girl I ever saw in my life that I would marry, I certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. You do seem to know that in married life, three is company, and two is none.
And that, my dear young friend, is the theory that the corrupt French drama has been propounding for the last 50 years.
And that the English film has proved in half the time.
Oh, for heaven's sake, don't try to be cynical. It is perfectly easy to be cynical.
It isn't easy to be anything nowadays. There's such a beastly competition about that sort of thing. Of course, you've been cynical. Oh, That was not Augusta. Only relatives or creditors ever been in that Bulbinarian manner. Now, if I get her out of the way for 10 minutes, so that you have the opportunity for proposing to Gwendolen, may I dine with you at Willis's tonight?
I suppose so, if you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who aren't serious about meals. It is so shallow of them.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Good afternoon, dear Algernon. I hope you are behaving well.
I am feeling very well, Dr. Augusta.
That's not exactly the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
Dear me, you are smart.
I am always smart. Am I not, Mr. Worthing?
You're quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I'm not that. It will leave no room for developments, and I intend to develop in many directions. I'm sorry if we are a little late, Algernon, but I was obliged to call on dear Lady Bracknell. I hadn't been there since her poor husband's death. I never saw a woman so altered. She looks quite 20 years younger. And now I'll have a cup of tea and one of those nice cucumber sandwiches and rolls.
Certainly, Aunt Augusta.
Won't you come sit here, Gwendolen?
Thanks, Mama. I'm quite comfortable where I am.
Good heavens! Lady! Where have you kept cucumber sandwiches?
I ordered them specially. There were no cucumbers on the market this morning, so I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for ready money.
That would do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I am really distressed, Aunt Augusta, about there being no cucumbers in the market. Not even for ready money.
It really makes no matter, Algernon. I had some purpose with Lady Harper, who seems to me to be living entirely for pleasure now.
I hear her hair has turned quite gold from grief.
It has certainly changed its colour, from what calls are, calls cannot say. Thank you. I've quite a treat for you tonight, Algernon. I'm going to send you down to Mary Farquhar. She is such a lovely and so attentive to her husband. It's delightful to watch.
I'm afraid, Dr. Augusta, I will have to give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight.
I hope not, Algernon. It would put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he's accustomed to that.
It is a great distress, but I have just got a telegram to say that my poor friend Bunbury is very ill again. They seem to think I should be with him.
It is strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes. Poor Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, I must say, I think it is high time that this Mr. Bunbury made up his mind whether he was going to live or to die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd. Nor do I in any way approve of the modern sympathy of invalids. I consider it morbid. Illness of any kind is hardly a thing to be encouraged in others. Health is the primary duty of life. I'm always telling that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take much notice, as far as any improvement in his ailment goes. But I would be much obliged, Algernon, if you would ask Mr. Bunbury from me to be so kind not to have a relapse. particularly at the end of the season, when everyone has practically said whatever they had to say, which in most cases was probably not much.
Oh, speak to Bunbury, Aunt Augusta, if he is still conscious. But I can promise you it will be all right by Saturday. Of course, the music is a great difficulty, you see. If one plays good music, people don't listen. And if one plays bad music, people don't talk. But if you kindly join me in the next room for a moment, I'd like to show you the program I've drawn out.
Thank you, Algernon. It is very thoughtful of you. I'm sure the program will be delightful. After a few explanations. French songs I cannot possibly allow. People always seem to think that they're in trouble, and I'm not shocked, which is vulgar, or laughed, which is worse. But German sounds to me a thoroughly respectable language, and I believe it's so. Gwendolen, you will accompany me.
Certainly, Mama.
Charming day it has been, Miss Fairfax.
Pray don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else. And that makes me so nervous.
I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I'm never wrong.
And I would like to be allowed to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary absence.
I would certainly advise you to do so. Mama has a way of bringing back something to a room that I've often had to speak to her about.
Gwendolen, ever since I met you, I have admired you more than any girl I've ever met since I met you.
Yes, I'm quite well aware of the fact that I often wish that in public, tenderly, a bit more demonstrative. For me, you have always had irresistible fascination. Before I met you, I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals. The fact is constantly mentioned in the more expensive monthly magazines, and has reached provincial pulpits, I am told. And my ideal has always been to love someone with the name of Ernest. There's something in that name that inspires absolute confidence. The moment Algernon first mentioned that he had a friend called Ernest, I knew I was destined to love you.
Do you really love me, Gwendolen?
Passionately.
Darling, you don't know how happy you have made me.
My own Ernest.
But you don't really mean to say you wouldn't love me if my name wasn't Ernest,
do you? But your name is Ernest.
Yes, I know it is, but supposing it was something else. Do you mean to say you couldn't love me then?
That is clearly a metaphysical speculation. And like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference at all to the actual facts of real life, as we know them.
Personally, darling, to speak quite candidly, I don't much care for the name of Ernest. I don't think the name suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has a music of its own. It produces vibrations.
Well, really, darling, I must say, I think there are lots of other, much nicer names. I think Jack, for instance, a charming name.
Jack? No, there is very little music in the name Jack, if any at all, indeed. It does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. I have known several Jacks, and they all, without exception, were more than usually plain. Besides, Jack was a notorious domesticity for John, and I pity anyone who was married to a man called John. She would probably never be allowed to know the entrancing pleasures of a single moment's solitude. The only real safe name is Ernest.
Gwendolen, I must be christened at once. I mean, we must get married at once. There is no time to be lost.
Married, Mr. Worthing?
Well, surely you know that I love you, and you have led me to believe, Miss Fairfax, that you
your answers be what a really affectionate mother requires. Do you smoke?
Well, yes, I must admit I smoke.
I'm glad to hear. A man should always have an occupation of some kind. There are far too many idle men in London as it is. How old are you?
29.
A very good age to be married at. I've always been of the opinion that a man who desires to get married should know either everything or nothing. Which do you know?
I know nothing, Lady Bracknell.
I'm pleased to hear it. I do not approve of anything that tempers natural ignorance. Ignorance is like a delicate, exotic fruit. Touch it, and the bloom is gone. The whole theory of modern education is radically outside. Fortunately, in England at any rate, education produces no effect whatsoever. If it did, it would prove fatal to the upper classes and probably lead to acts of violence in wrong as well. What is your income?
Between 7,000 and 8,000 a year.
In debt or in investments?
In investments, chiefly.
That is satisfactory. What between the duties expected from one during one's lifetime and the duties exacted from one after one's death, land ceases to be either a profit or a pleasure. It gives one a position and prevents one from keeping it up. That's all that can be said about land.
I have a country house with some land, of course, attached to it. About 1,500 acres, I believe. But I don't depend on that for my real income. In fact, as far as I can make out, the poachers are the only people who make anything out of it.
A country house? How many bedrooms? That can be cleared up afterwards. You have, I hope, a town house. A girl with a simple, unspoiled nature like Gwendolen could hardly be expected to reside in the country.
Well, I own a house in Belgrave Square, but it is let by the year to Lady Bracknell.
that unfortunate movement has led to. As for the particular locality of the handbag, the clothing at a railway station might serve to conceal some social indiscretion, has probably been indeed used for that purpose before now, but it could hardly be regarded as an assured basis for a recognized position in good society.
Well, what would you advise me to do? I need hardly say I would do anything in the world to ensure Gwendolen's happiness.
I strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to acquire some relations as soon as possible, and to make a definite effort at any rate to produce one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
Well, I don't see how I can possibly do that. I can produce the handbag at any moment, if you like. It is at my dress room at home. I really think that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What has it to do with me? You could hardly imagine that Lord Bracknell and myself would dream of allowing our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to marry into a cloak and form an alliance with a cock. Good morning.
Good morning. Oh, for heaven's sake, Algy! Stop playing that ghastly tune! How idiotic you are!
Did it go off all right, old boy? You don't mean to say that Gwendolen refused you. It is a way she has, always refusing people.
Oh, Gwendolen is as right as a trivet. As far as she is concerned, we are engaged. Her mother is perfectly embarrassed. I never met such a gorgon. I'm not quite sure what a gorgon is like, but I feel quite certain that Lady Bracknell is one. At any rate, she is a monster without a beard, which is rather unfair. I apologize. I suppose I shouldn't talk about your own aunt in this way before you.
My dear boy, I love hearing my relations abused.
Well, I won't argue with you about such things. You always want to argue about things. Nothing.
Did he always lose dress on your journey when he is leaving for town? I was thinking of that. And not my German lesson when the rector came in.
I hope, Cecily, you're not a detective.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prison's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically, my metaphor struck from bees. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from town yet.
We did not expect him until Monday afternoon.
Ah, yes. He usually likes to spend his Sunday in London. He's not one of those who saw in this enjoyment as where all of that is. That unfortunate young man his brother seems to be. But I must not disturb Algeria any people any longer.
Algeria? My name is Letitia London.
A classical illusion, Henry. Drops the cake in all first. I shall see you both, no doubt, in even song.
I think, dear doctor, I will have a stroll with you. It seems I have a headache after all, and walk might have good.
Pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We might go as far as the schools are back.
That would be delightful. Cecily, you will read your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the following week you may omit. It is somewhat too sensational and taking these metallic problems off the knowledge of outside.
Mr. Ernest Worthing has just driven over from Algy.
The station.
The station. He has brought his luggage with him.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, B4, the Albany West, Uncle Jack's brother. Did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Yes, miss. Seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you took his prism from the garden. Seemed very anxious to keep you private for a moment.
Ask Mr. Ernest Worthing to come here. And you had better talk to the housekeeper about a room for him.
Yes, miss.
Through my little cousin Cecily, I'm sure.
Believe me, I cannot deserve the illegitimate phrase. The precept, as well as the practice of the primitive church, was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church does not last forever at the present day. And you do not seem to realize, dear doctor, that by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent public temptation. Mention being more careful. This very seldom seems to be professors astray.
But the men are equally attractive when married.
No man is ever attractive, except to his wife.
And often, not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman, but surely can be depended on. Greatness can be trusted. Young women agree. I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor is drawn from foods, but where is Cecily?
Perhaps she follows the schools.
Mr. Worthing.
Mr. Worthing?
This is indeed surprise. We did not look for you till Monday afternoon.
I have returned sooner than I expected. Dr. Trossel, I hope you are well.
Dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of wave does not meet you against the terrible calamity.
My brother.
War shameful deaths and extravagance.
Still leaving his life of pleasure.
Dead.
Poor brother Ernest, dead?
Quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust you will profit by it.
Dear Mr. Woodley, I offer you my sincere condolences. You have at least the consolation of knowing you are always the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
Poor Ernest. He had many faults, but it is a sad, sad love.
Very sad indeed. Were you with him in the end?
No. He died abroad, in Paris, in fact. I had a telegram last night from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
Was the cause of death mentioned?
A severe chill, it seems.
As a man sows, so shall he reap.
Charity, dear Wisdom, charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to drops. Will the interpreter take place here?
No. He seems to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
In Paris? I fear that hardly points to any very serious state of the mind at last. You would no doubt wish me to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction this Sunday. My sermon on the meaning of the mana and the wounds can be adapted to almost any occasion. Joyful, or as in the present case, distressing. I have preached at hard celebrations, christenings, confirmations, intermiliations, and festival days. The last time I delivered it was in the cathedral for a charity sermon on behalf of the Society for the Prevention of Discontent among the Upper Orders. The bishop who was present was much struck by some of the analogies I drew.
Ah, that reminds me. You mentioned christenings, I think, Dr. Chosful. I suppose you don't want to christen, all right. I mean, of course, you are continually christening, aren't you?
It is, I've got to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. I have often spoken to the poor classes on this subject, but they don't seem to know what drift is.
But is there any particular infant in whom you are interested, Mr. Wilbur? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, was he not?
Oh, yes.
People who live entirely in pleasure usually are.
But it is not for any child, dear doctor. No, I am very fond of children. But the fact is, I would like to be christened myself this afternoon, if you have nothing better to do.
But surely, Mr. Worthing, you have been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
But have you any grave doubts on the subject?
I certainly intend to have. Of course, I don't know if the thing would bother you in any way, or if you think I am a little too old now.
Not at all. The sprinkling, and indeed the immersion of adults, is a perfectly canonical practice.
Immersion?
You need have no apprehensions. Sprinkling is all that is necessary, or indeed I think advisable. However, it is so changeable.
think it is perfectly absurd. Oh, good heavens.
Always overdressed as you are.
If I'm occasionally a little overdressed, might go and make arrangements for another Bunbury. Ah, there she is.
Oh, I'm really came back to water the roses. I thought you were with Uncle Jack.
He's gone to order the dog cart for me.
Oh, is he going to take me for a nice drive?
He's going to send me away.
Then we've got to part.
I'm afraid so. It is a very painful parting.
It is always painful to part from those whom one has known for a very brief space of time. The absence of old friends, one can endure for equanimity. But even a momentary separation from those whom one has just been introduced is almost unbearable.
Thank you.
Bad. You, of course, have formed the chief topic of conversation between
other name. But what name? Any name you like. Algernon, for instance. But I'd love the name of Algernon. But my own sweet, loving little darling, I really don't see why you should reject the name of Algernon. It is not at all a bad name. In fact, it's a rather aristocratic name. Half the chaps who get into bankruptcy court are called Algernon. But, say successfully, if my name was Algy, couldn't you love me?
I might respect you, Ernest. I might even admire your character. But I'm afraid I could not give you my undivided attention.
Cecily, your rector here is, I suppose, thoroughly experienced in all rites and ceremonials of the church.
Oh, yes. Dr. Chaucer was a most learned man. He has never written a single book, so you can only imagine how much he knows.
I must see him at once on a most important christening.
Yeah?
I mean, on most important business. I shan't be away for more than half an hour.
Considering that we have been engaged since February the 14th, and that we have only met today for the first time, I think it is rather hard that you should leave me for so long a period as half an hour. Couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in no time.
What an impetuous boy he is. I must copy his remarks into my diary.
Miss Fairfax has just called to see Mr. Worthing. On very important business, Miss Fairfax states.
Isn't Mr. Worthing in his library?
Mr. Worthing looked over the direction of the rectory some time ago.
Pray ask the lady to come out here. Mr. Worthing is sure to be back soon. And you can bring tea.
Yes, miss.
You are here on a short visit, I suppose.
Oh no, I live here.
Really? Your mother, no doubt, or some female relative in advanced years resides here also.
Oh no, I have no mother, nor in fact any relations.
Indeed.
My guardian, with the assistance of this prison, had the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
My name certainly is John. It has been John for years.
A gross deception has been practiced on the both of us!
My poor wounded Cecily!
My sweet rose, Gwendolen!
You will call me sister, will you not?
There is just one question I would like to be allowed to ask my guardian.
An admirable idea. Mr. Worthing, there is just one question we would like to be permitted to put to you. Where is your brother Ernest? We are both engaged in marriage to your brother Ernest, so it's a matter of some importance that we know where he is at present.
Cecily, Gwendolen, it is very difficult for me to be forced to speak the truth before you in this manner. It is the first time in my life that I have ever been reduced to such a painful position, and I am really quite inexperienced in doing anything of the kind. However, I will tell you quite candidly that I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all. I never had a brother in my life, and I certainly have not the smallest intention of ever having one in the future.
No brother at all?
None.
Had you never had a brother of any kind?
Never, not even of any kind.
I am afraid it is quite clear, dear Cecily, that neither of us is engaged to be married to anyone.
It is not a pleasant position for a young girl to suddenly find herself in, is it?
Let us go into the house. They will hardly venture to come after us there.
No, men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This ghastly state of things is what you call Bunbury, I suppose.
Yes, and a wonderful Bunbury it is.
The most wonderful Bunbury I've ever had in my life.
Well, you have no right whatsoever to Bunbury here.
Oh, that is absurd. One has a right to Bunbury anywhere one chooses. Every serious Bunburyist knows that.
Serious Bunburyist? Good heavens!
Well, one must be serious about something if one wants to have any amusement in life. What you are serious about, I haven't got the remotest knowledge. I, of course, happen to fancy everything. And I happen to be serious about Bunbury. You have such an absolutely trivial nature.
The only small satisfaction I have in the whole of this wretched business is that your friend Bunbury has quite exploded. You won't be able to run down to the country quite so often as you used to, dear Algy. And quite a good thing, too.
Your brother is a little off-colour, isn't he, dear Jack? You won't be able to disappear to London quite so frequently as your weekend custom was. And not a bad thing either.
And as for your conduct towards Miss Cardew, I must say, your taking a sweet, simple, innocent girl like that is quite inexcusable. To say nothing of the fact that she is my ward.
Well, I don't see any defense, Jack, in you deceiving a brilliant, clever, thoroughly experienced girl like Miss Fairfax. To say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin.
I wanted to be engaged to Gwendolen. That is all. I love her.
Well, I simply want to be engaged to Cecily.
unsure of your ever having been christened. You need hardly forget that a person closely connected with you was very nearly carried off in Paris, by a forbid too. Being christened might have made you very unwell.
Yes, but you said yourself that a severe chill was not hereditary.
It used to be, I know, but I dare say, science is always making wonderful improvements in things.
Oh, that is nonsense!
Jack, you're at the muffins again! I wish you wouldn't. Have tea cake instead.
But I hate tea cake.
Then why on earth do you allow it to be served up for your guest? What I did, you have hospitality!
Algernon, I have already told you to leave. Why won't you go? I don't want you here.
I haven't had any tea yet, and there's still one muffin left.
The fact that they did not follow us at once into the house, as anyone else should have done, seems to me to show they have some sense of
I would consider it wrong
have also in my possession, and you will be pleased to hear, certificates of Miss Cardew's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles, both the German and the English variety.
Ah, a life crowded with incident, I see. Although perhaps somewhat too exciting for a young girl. I myself am not in favor of premature experiences. Quick, I believe that the time has come for our departure. We really must be on. As a matter of course, I admit asking if Miss Cardew has any little fortune.
Oh, about £130,000 in the funds. That is all. Goodbye, Lady Bracknell. I'm so pleased to have seen you.
A moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000. And in the funds. Miss Cardew seems to be a most attractive young lady down at our river. Few girls of the present day have any really solid qualities. Any of the qualities that mark steady. Come over here. Pretty child. Your dress is sadly simple. And your hair seems almost as nature might have left it. But we can soon alter all that. A thoroughly experienced French maid produces a really marvelous result in a very brief space of time. I remember recommending one to young Lady Knox, and after 3 months, her own husband did not know her.
And after 6 months, nobody knew her.
Kindly turn round, sweet child. No, the side view is what I want. As I expected. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile. The two weak points in our age are its want of principle and its want of profile. The gin is high, dear. Style nowadays largely depends on how the gin is worn. They are worn very hard just at present. Algy.
Yes, Andreas.
There are distinct social possibilities in Miss Cardew's profile.
Cecily is the sweetest, dearest, prettiest girl in the whole world. I don't care two pits about social possibilities.
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Algernon. Only people who can't get into it do that. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Cecily, you may kiss me.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell.
And you may also call me Aunt Augusta for the future.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
The marriage, I think, had better take place quite soon.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
I am not in favor of long engagements. They give people the opportunity of finding out each other's character before marriage, which I think is never advisable.
I beg your pardon for interrupting you, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid to say that this engagement is quite out of the question. I'm Miss Cardew's guardian. And she cannot marry without my consent until she comes of age. That consent I absolutely decline to give.
Upon what grounds, may I ask? Algernon is a very, I may almost say, an ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing, but he looks everything. What more can one desire?
It pains me very much, Lady Bracknell, to have to speak friendly to you about your nephew. I'm afraid the fact is, I do not approve at all of his moral character. I suspect him of being untruthful.
Untruthful?
important question of romance. He gained admission to my house by the false pretense of being my brother. Under an assumed name he drank, I've just been informed by my butler, an entire pint bottle of Ypelier Jumet Brut 89, wine I was specially reserving for myself. Continuing his disgraceful deception, he succeeded in the course of the afternoon in alienating the affections of my only ward. He subsequently sneaked in tea and devoured every single muffin. And, what makes his conduct all the more heartless is that he was perfectly well aware from the first that I have no brother, that I have never had a brother, and that I don't intend to have a brother, not even of any kind. I distinctly told him so myself yesterday afternoon.
Mr. Wayne, after careful consideration, I have decided to entirely overlook my nephew's conduct to you.
How extremely generous of you, Lady Bracknell. My own decision on the matter, however, is unalterable. I decline to give my consent.
Come over here. How old are you?
Well, I'm really only 18, but I always hit 20 when I go out to evening parties.
You are perfectly right in making some slight alteration. No woman should ever be quite accurate about her age. It looks so calculated. 18, but admitted to 20 at evening parties. Well, it will not be long before you are of age and free from the restraints of tutelage, so I don't think your guardian's consent is, after all, a matter of any importance.
I beg your pardon for interrupting you again, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid to say that under the terms of her grandfather's will, Miss Carew does not legally come of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to me to be a grave objection. 35 is a very attractive age. London society is full of women of the very highest birth who have, of their own free choice, remained 35 for years. Lady Dunnington is an instance in point. She has been 35 ever since she arrived at the age of 40. Which was many years ago now. So I don't see any reason why our dear Cecily should not be any more attractive in the age that you mentioned than she is at present. There will be a large accumulation of property.
Algy, could you wait for me till I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You know I could.
I felt instinctively that you could. But I will not wait all that time. I hate waiting 5 minutes for anybody. I am not punctual myself, I know. But I do like punctuality in others. So waiting, even to be married, is quite out of the question.
Then what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Miss Moncrieff.
Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states positively, that she cannot wait till she is 35, a remark which I am bound to say shows a somewhat impatient nature, I beg of you to reconsider your decision.
But my dear Lady Bracknell, the matter is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolen, I will most gladly allow your nephew to form an alliance with my lord.
You must be aware that what she knows is quite out of the question.
Then a passionate celibacy is all any of us can look forward to.
That is not the destiny I propose for Gwendolen. Algernon, of course,
quite ready for the christenings.
The christenings? Is that not somewhat premature?
Both of these gentlemen have expressed a desire for an immediate party.
At their age, the idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. Lord Bracknell would be highly displeased if he learned that this was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
I understand then that there are to be no christenings at all this afternoon.
I don't think that, as things are now, it would be a much practical value to our lives.
It grieves me to hear such sentiment from you, Mr. Worthing. They say the political views of the Anabaptists, views that I have completely refuted in former unpublished sermons. However, as your present view seems to be one peculiarly secular, I must return to the church at once. Indeed, I have just been informed by the pure man that the last hour and a half has given into waiting for me in the vestry.
Prison. Did I hear you mention a Miss Prison?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. I'm on my way to join her.
Pray, allow me to retain you for a moment. Is this Miss Prison at all a female of repellent aspect, remotely connected with education?
She is the most cultivated of ladies, the very picture of respectability.
It is obviously the same person. May I ask what position she holds in your household?
I am a fluent man.
Miss Prism, Lady Bracknell, has been for the last 3 years Miss Carter's esteemed governess and valued companion.
In spite of what I hear, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
She approaches. She is mine.
I've been waiting for you for an hour and 3 quarters.
Prism! Prism! Come here, Prism! Prism! Where is that baby? 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house. Number 104 of the Grosvenor Street, in charge of a perambulator that contained a baby of the male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered in a remote corner of Bayswater. The perambulator contained a 3-volume manuscript of more than usually voting sentimentality, but the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, I am ashamed and do not know. I only wish I did, but the plain facts of the case were these. On the morning of the day you mentioned, a day that is found branded in my memory, I have prepared to take the baby out of the perambulator for usual. I have also with me a summer old, a capacious handbag in which I had intended to place the manuscript of a work of fiction which I had written during my few unoccupied hours. In a moment of mental distraction, for which I could never forgive myself, I placed the manuscript in the basket and the baby in the handbag.
But where did you deposit the handbag?
Do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, this is a matter of no small importance to me. I insist on knowing where you deposited the handbag that contained that infant.
I left it in the cloakroom from the large railway station to London.
Which railway station?
Victoria, the Brighton Line.
I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolen, wait here for me.
If you are not too long, I will wait here for you all my life.
What do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I dare not even suspect. Strange coincidences are not supposed to occur in families of high position. They are hardly considered to the thing.
Uncle Jack seems strangely agitated.
Your guardian has a very emotional nature. have stopped now.
Now I remember. remember that the general was called Ernest. I knew I had some particular reason for disliking the name.
Gwendolen, it is a terrible thing for a man to find out that all his life he has been speaking nothing but the truth. Can you forgive me?
I can, for I feel sure that you are to change.
I am one. Leticia.
Frederick, at last.
Cecily, at last.
Gwendolen, at last.
My nephew, you seem to be displaying signs of triviality.
On the contrary, Aunt Augusta, for the first time in my life, I have realized the vital importance of being earnest.
Time, most of them were unable performed in that show when we did it, an adapted version of it, the year after. And the person who was supposed to be our lead was Miss Allison Eyre.
Thank you.
hoping that they will find their home with us on this stage. And now, we have a couple more. You have been so much help this production. I cannot thank you enough. And even though I know that Ali is moving on, you have no skin in the game, so to speak, with the company got moving forward, I hope that you continue. We have so many.